This is Dr. Martin's supplemental lecture on section 5 of chapter 35. I'm going to be talking about two concepts, one of which is actually not discussed in your book. I'm going to talk about, again, we're still talking about communities. So the first concept that I would like to talk about is the idea of keystone species. And these are species whose importance in a community is actually critical to the structure of that community. So that means that any change in the keystone species will dramatically impact the community. The term keystone comes from actually an architectural term referring to the building of a doorway, at least using stone. As you place the stones there is one stone at the very top that actually is critical to the entire structure, and that's called the keystone. So that word or term was used to apply to this concept in ecology. So I'm going to talk a little bit about probably one of the most often cited examples of keystone species, and that is the importance of the sea otter in an aquatic community, and in this community. This is a marine environment. There are brown algae called giant kelp that are anchored on the ocean floor, and they come up, they can be very, very tall, and they provide, it's almost like a forest. And within that forest are a number of organisms that are dependent on each other. So the sea otter, the giant kelp, and the third member of this group are small invertebrates that are called sea urchins. Okay, so let's talk about this particular, so the keystone species is the sea otter. All right. So the location of this particular community is the Pacific Coast. And the reason that we know of the importance of the keystone species is a historical fact. In the late 1800s to early 1900s, the sea otters were hunted almost to extinction. Now, the impact of that was tremendous on this particular community. What happened is that there was a tremendous increase in sea urchins, in the population of sea urchins, and in turn, a decrease in the kelp, the brown algae. So the community essentially fell apart. And the reason behind that is as follows. In the normal scheme of things, the sea otter feeds on sea urchins, and the sea urchins in turn feed on the kelp and other organisms. So basically, the sea otter is controlling the population of sea urchins. The sea urchins in turn have a tremendous effect on the number of individuals in the kelp forest. So once we remove this layer, these organisms increase in population numbers, and therefore the greater the number of the sea urchins, the greater the herbivory on the kelp. Okay, a second concept that I want to talk about, still relating to communities, is the idea of succession. This is called ecological succession, and this is defined as a change in time of the species that make up a community in a specific place. So when scientists study succession, they pick out an area, and they might use historical records to go back to looking at that same area and the plants that might have been there 50 years ago, 100 years ago, and so on. We can distinguish between two types of succession. We have what is called primary succession and secondary succession. All right, so let's take a look at each of these in turn. Okay, primary succession occurs on a barren landscape, and I should say that succession, usually we're talking about plants in a given area. And what I mean by barren, an example might be a newly formed island that was formed from an eruption of a volcano. So we have suddenly an area of land that is totally devoid of any, at least initially, of any life forms. And so the if we were to, here's the ocean, and here's our new island. Over time, we can describe the population of plants that inhabit this island. And the very first organisms that might be found there, they're usually called pioneer species. And oftentimes, those are actually lichens, because lichens have the ability to live on a very rocky surface. And the action of the lichens actually helps break down that rock in the conversion to soil. So, lichens might be the first species. And then over time, many other species follow. Typically, in a given environment, 50 to 100 years later, the species that are present might remain stable or unchanged. For many, many years. And that community is called the climax community. So that's the stable community that is the end result of a series of changes over time. The reason that we see succession is that typically the initial environment is changed by the species that land there first, and they alter the environment in a way that makes it more favorable for other species of plants to reside there. And over time, those changes finally lead to a community that might reside there for many, many years. Okay, that's primary succession. In this part of the country, the type of succession that we see all around us, you may not have noticed, but if you look around, you'll see lots of examples of secondary succession. And this is the change in species over time in a disturbed landscape. So this would be an area that, for example, a plowed field will not initially have any plants if it's, we'll say that it's been, we'll call it an old plowed field. So it's a field that was plowed and never planted, and there's been no disturbance to it. We can look at what happens to the plants in that field over time. In this part of the country, typically, we would, of course, see weeds. Weeds aren't really, that's not really a biological term, but you know what I mean. So, pioneer species that are undesirable to most of us. A little bit later, there might be grasses and flowering, other flowering plants that are non-woody. We might see later shrubs and smaller trees. Around here, couple of species of trees that seem to be early inhabitants of an ecosystem that's undergoing change, that is an example of secondary. Sweet gum, sometimes birches. These are trees that are very fast growing, but they Once they get overshadowed by more mature trees like oaks and beeches and so on, they no longer have a suitable environment, so they usually will decline over time. So in this part of the country, a forest, a certain type of forest, would be the end result of secondary succession. Now, and then we call that a climax community. Obviously, there's many disturbances, natural disturbances, strong winds, tornadoes, hurricanes, etc., that are going to disturb that community in some way, and the community will respond. And in the area that was damaged, you might see some of these previous species take over, but ultimately the landscape will go back to the climax community.